First of all, she does a pretty good impersonation of Rick Davis. It's really, and just so if I don't get too concerned, I'm not going to look at this too much, but it will keep me on track. Having this opportunity to be here, it is truly an honor. And it's something that I take seriously. If somebody asks us to do something that we're capable of doing, and we don't do it, or we turn down the offer because we're embarrassed, or it's awkward, or we don't feel confident, all of these reasons that we all have, every one of those reasons is a self-centered reason. So when I was asked to be here tonight and share my stories, you know, Dale Lynn will tell you, as I'm driving down today, I said, I'm at that point where I'm asking myself, why do I get myself in these things? I get myself in these things because I think I have an obligation and an opportunity to give something back. So that's why I'm here, and I'm honored that you guys are here, especially on a nice day. You know, college kids coming in, they're based from the old library on a nice evening. I can tell you, I probably wouldn't have been one of them. At any rate, it is an honor and pleasure to be here. And the stories that shape us, I have a little bit of a reputation, I guess, as being a storyteller. And Nancy Plyer sent me a text, and she asked if I was going to please edit the story. And I told her, I don't edit, I embellish. So it's just I had the opportunity to see the video with Rocky last week, and he did a fabulous job. But, you know, it's interesting when I thought about it, Rocky's years in Beaver Falls and my years in Beaver Falls are very, very different. Okay, I was born in 1952. I moved in 1984 to Atlanta, Georgia. Rocky was born in 85, and of course he's been here, we've been here about the same amount of years, but you know, my years were the glory years, so to speak, of Beaver Falls. I mean, it was the center of the universe, I used to tell people, and still do. The mills were humming. The community was booming. The time I was here was absolutely, in my estimation, and anybody that's known me even for a week would tell you I had the best childhood in the world. Being in Beaver Falls was the best place to grow up in the whole world, and I genuinely believe that. Rocky's perspective of Beaver Falls from 85 on, it's not booming, it's in decline. And it's a different perspective. And with all due respect to Rocky, who presented a very positive message, I have a more positive image of Beaver Falls than he does. Because my memories of Beaver Falls are different than his. It's not because I'm a more positive person. This is all about Beaver Falls and how it shaped us. Beaver Falls shaped me at a time when I, again, call it the center of the universe. And I'll share that my first story with you about Beaver Falls being the center of the universe. And anybody here from New Brighton, by the way? Oh, good, I won't offend you. there was always that great rivalry between New Brighton and Beaver Falls. And so I'd always dig the New Brighton people, and I'd tell them, well, New Brighton is nothing more than a suburb of Beaver Falls. And that just always offended the New Brighton people. It really made them mad, which made me happy. You know, it was banter. And then as we got older, it was just fun, good fun banter. My beautiful wife, Dylan, and I were with two couples, both of them from New Brighton. Terry Francona was managing the Philadelphia Phillies at the time. And he hosted us, if you want to call it that, at a Phillies game. So there were all of probably 5,000 people in the stadium. The Phillies were really bad. And we went into the private club sports bar that they have there. And we walked in there, and there was nobody in this place. And there was one tall, distinguished black man sitting at one of the high board tables by himself. I recognize him. It was Harold Carmichael. A lot of people in this room don't remember Harold Carmichael. A lot of people do. Hall of Fame wide receiver for the Philadelphia Eagles. Relative that I have to think about it, but recently retired from the NFL. So I told everybody I was with, which are four people from New Brighton, two from Beaver Falls, I said, let's go over and talk to him. So we walked over, we introduced ourselves. He was a very nice guy, very articulate guy. We had a real good conversation, had a, you know, a beer with him or whatever, and it dawned on me that Poe James played for Philadelphia, probably at the same time Harold Carmichael did. So Poe James was from New Brighton, okay? And Poe James was New Brighton's biggest star. So I asked Harold Carmichael, I said, do you know Poe James? And he said, Poe James, he said, one of my very best friends. And he looked at me, because I'd already told him I was from Beaver Falls. He looked at me and he said, well, he's from Beaver Falls, isn't he? New Brighton people in unison. No, he's from New Brighton. Alien is my witness. Harold Carmichael looked at him and he said, isn't that a suburb of Beaver Falls? center of the universe. I'm going to give you one more, okay? If that got a laugh, this is Beaver Falls, center of the universe. I'm in California. I'm at a golf course. I'm playing golf. I go into the clubhouse afterwards. I see a guy that I recognize, Art Howe. Who knows who Art Howe is? He had a 12-year major league career, probably 12, 10, 15, whatever years, manager of the Astros and the Oakland A's, but he's from Pittsburgh. So I went up to Art Howe, introduced myself, shook his hand, and I said, I'm from Beaver Falls. Well, he was sitting down, and when I told him I'm from Beaver Falls, he jumped up, and we're still shaking hands, and he says to me, do you know? Well, what's he going to say? Do you know?
Joe Namath.
Do you know Jumbo Suskowitz? Jumbo Suskowitz? I said, yeah, I know him. I said, but nobody's ever asked me. True story.
That's funny.
Listen, it's the stories that chase us. It's all about Beaver Falls. But you can't tell a story without people being central to that story. And the people in Beaver Falls that shape my life are what make all the difference in the world. And we all have our own stories to tell. We live in a world now that we don't, you need to be careful who your heroes are. Okay, you need to be really careful. And I'm talking to anybody in the room, I don't care how old you are. You know, we get so carried away with heroes and idols and this type of thing. I mean, it's like we don't have enough of it. We have to even make up a show, American Idol, so we can just keep making more of it, you know? And it's so important to pick heroes that are worth following. And in my office, I have two pictures. Both of them are childhood heroes. One is Roberto Clemente. Question, who has not ever heard of Roberto Clemente? Good, I'm glad to hear. The other one's Billy Starter. And behind my desk is a team picture. No, it's not a team picture. It's a classic picture that if you were into photography, you would know this picture because the composition is so awesome. It won awards everywhere. It's a picture, and raise your hand as I describe it if you've seen this picture. There are on one of the outcroppings on the Cathedral of Learning, there are a group of kids, maybe 8, 10, 12 Pitt students, and their hands are in the air, and you can tell they're celebrating. And looking from higher up on that Pitt Cathedral, looking straight down into Ford's Field, that's the moment Mazeroski hit the home run in the bottom of the ninth inning of the 1960 World Series. So that picture's there. Clemente, Stargell. When somebody gets hired in our company, and I'll talk a little about the company in a little bit. When somebody gets hired, at some point in the interview process, they come into my office. And when they're in my office, they get this story, and they get it with passion, and they get it conviction, and they get it in a way that it's challenging to them. Because I tell them, if our culture and our values don't fit you, don't kid yourself, you're not going to succeed, okay? And here's the story. Number one, that picture, I've given the stats. The stats from that World Series are ridiculous. Ridiculously weighted in favor of the New York Yankees. And I'm not prepared to give all those stats now, but it's 50-some runs to 20-some runs. Whitey Ford pitched two shutouts, which is the World Series record. The first, and I think only, MVP of the World Series that came from the losing team, Bobby Richardson. Hall of Fame players, Mano, Maris, Barra, you name it, all over the place. And the Pirates had been the doormat of the National League for probably the entire 50s. They won the World Series. The best team, not the superstar players, won. Then I ask them about Clemente. I tell them about Clemente. Here's a guy that on New Year's Eve, but one of the highest paid, most best recognized athletes in the world. Okay, this is like A-Rod today. Okay, on New Year's Eve, 1972, I think, he has a party at his house, and he's so concerned about earthquake victims in Nicaragua. This man's only been to Nicaragua one time in his life. He's not Nicaraguan, doesn't have any family there, but he's so concerned. This is one of the most highest paid, most highly recognized, superstar athletes in the world. He gets on an overloaded cargo plane because the Sandinistas in Nicaragua are stealing all the medical and food supplies before the people that need them can get them. Now, you guys imagine this happening in 2016. I'm going to tell you, it ain't going to happen. Okay? A-Rod's not going to get on a cargo plane and go save anybody. And I'm not knocking A-Rod. That's his first name came to mind. Clemente, before he got on that plane, his agent, they probably didn't call him agents back then, said to him, was begging him, don't get on that plane. Roberto Clemente told him, he said, nobody dies a day early. They die when you're supposed to. The plane crashed and he died. Okay? There's somebody who sacrificed his life out of concern for people he didn't even know. To that degree, even though he was of a superstar stature, okay, that tells you something. Be selfless. Willie Stargell. Everybody remembers, I assume, Willie Stargell. How many home runs did he hit in his career? 475. Okay? Before steroids, and this was before the steroid era, if you hit 500 home runs, you have just stamped your ticket to the Hall of Fame. And Willie Stargell was sitting on 475, had a bad knee. New York Yankees, because they had a DH in the American League, New York Yankees offered him a 3-year multi-million-dollar contract. And Willie Stargell retired, 25 home runs short. And he said, my roots run deep, and my roots are in Pittsburgh. And if you try to uproot an old oak tree, it'll die. He said, if I leave Pittsburgh, I'll die. And based on loyalty to the city, he retired, did not hit any more home runs. And so loyalty, selflessness, and a team concept. If that fits you, you're probably a candidate for pure red. No, I'm not, this isn't. But the point is, I'm going to share with you some of the heroes, and I'm going to tell you stories behind the heroes. And these are heroes in Beaver Falls that if you know the Davis family, you know them. If you don't know the Davis family, you've got people in your family that are just like you. And I know we share a lot of these same blessings. But the first hero I'd like to show you. This is my family. That's my grandfather. He's affectionately known as Jiddu. Jiddu is an Arabic word for grandfather. They're from Syria. Okay, you guys, they're refugees. If you were Syrian and you were Christian in the early 1900s, if you were Christian and lived in any Muslim nation, nothing's changed. But it's even worse. If your father, if you don't have a father, a male figure in the household, My grandfather's father died in Syria. So now, women, doesn't matter if you're Christian or Muslim, you have no status at all in a Muslim nation. But the point is, if you're a Christian, trying to raise six kids without a father, it's impossible. So somehow they miraculously made their way to the United States. He never owned a house. He raised four kids and 16, helped raise 16 grandkids. His oldest son is a retired engineer and was a World War II fighter pilot. His second daughter, they grew up in Rochester. Anybody know any slime? But Wilma had that with a hat at. His second son and third child was Dr. George Haddad. Does anybody know him? Mm-hmm. Yep, he's a sweetheart of a sweetheart, I'll tell you that. And then I got a lot of order. His third child was my mom. But my grandfather taught us that there are no bad days. If he heard us say, complain about the weather, complain about anything, you got scolded, you got jumped on. He had a positive, outgoing attitude, and there were no hurdles that could hold him back. And that family of immigrants, growing up in the Hill District of Pittsburgh, okay, I have a lot of family that went the wrong way, and didn't do things the right way. These guys, he went to work in the steel mills. When he was 14 years old, he's living in the Hill District of Pittsburgh, working 80 or 90 hours a week in the steel mills of Pittsburgh, which there was no pollution control back then, guys. It was worse than you can possibly imagine. And as a 14-year-old, he was the breadwinner for his grandmother, his mother, and his five siblings. Okay? A guy like that will teach you something to help you build character. These stories are important. Next picture. I am an emotional guy, but I am not going to break down in front of this group of strangers. That's my mother. Okay? Special beyond words. Growing up in Blue Town, or Blue Collar, Beaver Falls, you know, four boys, no girls in the family. I had a brother, Tim, 1 year older, brother Dan, 2 years older, my brother Jeff's 9 years younger. But, you know, our house was Grand Central Station. Everybody'd be there, sleep there overnight, play basketball and drive or whatever. If two boys got in a fight, my mother had a great rule. Okay, first of all, we always had two sets of 16-ounce boxing gloves. If you know anything about boxing, 16-ounce gloves, and Bobby Bly can tell you all about it, it's almost like a pillow. They're well packed, okay? But the two combatants had to go in the backyard. They're in front of my mother. Well, you know, you lose your motivation. Without the other guys coaching you and instigating. But what she was selfish. And you'll hear me use that word a lot. And go to the next picture. It was the best thing I could find of her doing something selfless with our firstborn, J.D., named after my dad. But my dad, as all dads did, I think, back then, my dad ruled the house. I mean, there's no question who was the boss, okay? But he knew if my mother was doing something for somebody in need, if it was the 12-year-old paper girl and she needed somebody to talk to, dinner waited until my mother was done, giving her time to that 12-year-old paper girl. And in those situations, my dad knew not to cross her. And what I learned from her, of course, in terms of selflessness, Jiddu gave me courage and faith. She gave me selflessness. And let's go to the fourth picture. That's a good-looking guy there. That's my dad. And that's my brother Dan. That guy taught me more things without talking than anybody I could possibly tell you. I mean, all of our fathers were John Wayne types, okay? But he was such a strong person in terms of demanding that we do our best. Demanding that we are honest and truthful. Demanding that we are respectful of women, and especially my mom. And I tell you what, if he found out some of the things that we, none of us are afraid of our moms, let's face it, but if he found out we had crossed swords with her, there was a price to pay. But the one thing he taught me that served me better than anything else was work ethic. Okay, work ethic. I'm gonna tell you, nobody ever outworked that guy. Okay, we're still talking about healers. Let's go to the next picture. Now that's a fine looking couple, if I've ever seen. I told people for many years, and I'll tell you guys now, my hero is sitting in the last row of my life. And there's a lot of reasons for that. But when we moved down to Georgia, and I, because of the times, I struggled a lot up here for a few years. And it was just difficult to find a good job. It was difficult to make a living. Finally relocated to Atlanta, but Gail Lynn had a fine teaching career. She taught at Elwood City High School. She taught at Globe City College, and she was currently teaching at Beaver County Community College. And when we moved to Georgia, on my fat salary of $14,000 a year, she quickly got three offers from three different colleges, making twice and then some more than I was making. We wrestled over our a 3-year-old son had never spent an hour in a daycare. I mean, he never left the neighborhood. The next door was my brother Dan and Diane, and we lived next door with my mom and dad. You get the picture. But so we had to wrestle with, okay, are we going to take this little kid who's never ever been around anybody but family and friends, and are we going to farm him out to an institution with a bunch of strangers? No, I'm not knocking daycare. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm talking about is somebody that says, you know, and it was 100% her decision. I really, honestly, did not weigh in on it. And she made the decision to stay home, to raise our then three kids. And if she goes to work, we probably don't have, I know we don't have three kids. We might not ever have two kids. But at any rate, what it allowed us to do, because the successes we've realized together, it so freed me up to be able to dedicate myself to my job and have the peace of mind necessary to be able to focus on a career and grow that career without her support. I'm going to tell you, I'm still a customer service manager or whatever at Pure Ray Creative, instead of being the retired CEO. So, my hero, Gail Lynn, thank you again. Okay, next picture. One more about Gail Lynn. I forgot I put that one in there. This is all about the stories that shape us, right? And this story happened in Beaver Falls. Around a day or two or three, and Gail Lynn would be updated back. Day or two or three after my mother's funeral, our 6.5-year-old son JD severely broke his left femur. It required surgery and being set. That position he's in, he stayed in that position and couldn't move for 5 weeks. 6 weeks, I don't know, a long time. Poor kid, while he's laying there, got mumps. Oh. Chicken pox, okay, I didn't get that happened to Beaver Falls. God is great. It happened to Beaver Falls, where we had lots and lots of support. Okay, I tell the funny story because I would rush back from wherever I was Friday afternoon to go from Pittsburgh Airport straight to Beaver County Medical Center. I'm in a suit and tie. I forgot something. Our daughter Jill, during that 6-week period, was born also. Jill was born in Beaver Falls. Minor detail. But so when I go to the medical center in my suit and tie, I go to the pediatric ward. I go to the maternity ward. I go to see the new babies. I mean, nurses were no joke, people were calling me doctor. Some of the time I walked around with Uncle George, Dr. Haddad, and people would call me doctor, but that was my favorite. Let's go next. Alright. Lessons. Friends. Friends from Beaver Falls. Okay? Don't be intimidated by the gang signs, okay? this intimidating looking group are friends for a lifetime, okay? Friends for a lifetime. And there's a scripture that talks about a friend that stays closer than a brother. Okay, that's part of how do your friends get you? And that's something you really, really have to think about. And pick good friends. I'm not sure if I picked them or they picked me, but I stand here as a very, very blessed man, and I've had some great friends. Bobby Blyatt asked me to be the best man at his wedding. I don't know if I was any good at it. I probably wasn't, but nonetheless, it was an honor that I remember to this day. Now, the last picture. That doesn't make you smile. I mean, if you've ever seen a group of star basketball players, admit it, that's it. Right? I mean, would you agree? There's some studly characters in there. Okay. Well, Butch Cassidy, somebody has to get over there on the left. He's sitting in the back of the room. The guy with the flyaway collars is me. The story behind that, and I checked it with Jack today, Jack Fulham is another one of my good friends, that has had a huge influence on a lot of people. But in terms of being a coach, a teacher, a mentor by design, a mentor without even knowing it, as I observed how he operated and the character, the fairness, the impartiality, it had a huge impact on me. And Jack, thank you very much. This is Jack's oldest son. That's Jack's youngest son. And I had just finished at Slipknot, and something had happened. I asked Jack earlier today if he remembered, but the two coaches resigned from coaching that sixth grade team, 12-year-old team, whatever it was, and I got a call, and he asked if I would do it. I called Bob, and we jumped at the opportunity. We inherited these kids. What are you going to do? You get the bad news bears, you got to come up with a way to coach them. So this gets into what this message is about, and hopefully people, all of you, take something away from this that really helps you in your life. But, so what we do? We identified the fundamentals. Okay? That's sports talk. But you got to have fundamentals. We identified the fundamentals. We coached to the fundamentals. And they execute to the fundamentals to the best of their ability. Okay? So that opportunity to coach those kids, that's one of those opportunities in life where you make the most of it, you enjoy every minute of it, and you understand there are more important things to life than winning. All of these experiences, I think that these are shared blessings. I think that we can all say that we share these blessings to some degree. If you're here, and you haven't had I say this without apology, I say it with an attitude of thanksgiving. If your life hasn't been as blessed as mine, and I'm talking about family and friends, that's okay. Okay? Adversity hits everyone. Okay? And whatever it is, I met a guy, one of the most enthusiastic, motivating people I ever met in my life, and you can Google this guy. Lieutenant Cleve McClear, and he had a vanity plate, homemade vanity plate, on the front of his pickup truck, and it said Fido, like the dog's name, F-I-D-O, and what it meant was, forget it, drive on. Forget it, drive on. Now, And then he'd go on to say, if your mother's alcoholic, fight him, man. Forget to drive on. And he had all, you know. But here's a guy, when he's telling you this, and he's standing there having come out of Vietnam, and he got blown up, blew off his left arm, blew off the left side of his face, he lost his left eye. Took 39 surgeries before he was ever able to walk again. And when this guy, with his scarred face and his mangled right hand, and his huge, enthusiastic, positive attitude that it's just so contagious, when he tells you, forget it, drive on, that really makes, drives the point home. So I don't have any excuses. And I, you did a great job introducing Rocky last week. And I, poor Jackie, she had very little work with me. The introduction of Rocky as great student, apparently, great athlete, obviously, much younger, good looking guy, but that's beside the point. But you know, I have to admit to you, Jackie didn't have that ammunition to work with in my case, but that doesn't mean that I wasn't learning the lessons and building that character and coming up with those solid, rock solid foundations to build a successful life on. And so now we go into my next 31 years. In 1984, we moved to Atlanta. I got hired by a company, for all intents and purposes, it was in the printing industry. I knew nothing about what they did. They hired me, in all honesty, I think the reason I got hired, the owner of this company was very close friends with an owner of another company that my brother Dan, my oldest brother, had moved to Atlanta 2 years before me. He had done such a phenomenal job working for this construction company that the owner said, listen, Dan Davis is the best hire I've ever made. If his brother's anything like him, he ought to hire him. I think that's what got me hired, because I had zero qualifications for the job. And I knew I had zero qualifications for the job. So, and I moved down for $14,000 a year. I uprooted, times were desperate back in 1984 in this area, but we moved down there. My wife, my son, we go to work every day. I go in, as I learned to do. My coach, my wife Dylan, said, dress for the job you want, not the job you have. I went into work every day in a suit and a tie, or at least a sports coat and tie. And everybody else in that customer service department were jeans, t-shirts, very casual. Every day, in my suit and tie, I walked into the owner's office, and I had this burning passion. I wanted to be a salesperson. And I'd tell him, I want to be in sales. And he'd say, yeah, that's fine. And he'd say, next day, I did it every day. Well, about 6 years or 6 months later, I was in sales. But I was so worried about keeping my job that at the end of the day, and I didn't care what anybody thought of it, okay, I was far beyond those immature days where I was trying to impress my peers. I wasn't trying to impress my coworkers. I was trying to impress the owner of that company, because I had a wife and kid to take care of and more kids on the way, thankfully. But so, at the end of the day, it wasn't unusual for me to take off my tie, take off my coat, roll up my sleeves, fill up a bucket. There were about maybe 60 people in the building, and I would mop the whole floor. It would take me about 4 hours to mop and wax the floor, and people would make fun of me, people would ridicule me, people would make a joke. It didn't bother me one bit, okay, because I was focused on pleasing the right person. At one point, somebody was complaining about all the overtime. We used to work a lot of overtime. They were complaining about the overtime. And I got pulled into a conversation in the lunchroom. And this Bob Wood was the guy's name, and he said something, I don't remember exactly, but he called it slave labor. And I said, Bobby, do you get paid? And he said, yeah. I said, slaves don't get paid. I said, let me tell you something. Don't say anything in front of me that you don't want Doug Thomas, the owner of the company, to hear. and I walked out of the lunchroom. I wasn't down there to make friends. I already had all the friends I needed, okay? But that approach to that job and the way we went about it, I mean, the first year I was there was a very bad year. They laid off 25% of the company in January, the first January. First January I was working there, and probably because I was only making $14,000 a year, I was easy to keep, but I think it might have had something to do with me going the extra mile. So the Pure Red story, it's a story of success. It's a story that's built on the homegrown fundamentals that I learned in Beaver Falls. And it starts, guys, with leadership. And I'll tell you what leadership is not. Leadership is not a title. Leadership is an action. You can be a leader if you choose to be a leader. You want to worry about your buddy who's going to buy your beer after work? Misplaced loyalty, okay? Choose to be a leader. Leadership is an action, and it's not a title. So what we did, and I'm going to fast forward. I worked my way up in the company and was able to get in a position of influence and a position of authority. And so we established some fundamentals. Okay, there are fundamentals this basketball team had to learn. Fundamentals of dribbling, passing, boxing out, shooting, whatever. So the fundamentals we established started with leadership. I just said leadership's not a title, it's an action. Okay, but leadership is critical. So it starts with leadership. So we established a leadership philosophy. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or feigned deceit. Are you familiar with this? Rather, in humility, consider others above yourselves. Look not only on your own interests, but look also on the interests of others. In a word, selflessness. Let me tell you what we did as a company. Okay, we had the opportunity to have a management buyout. I led a management buyout with a single owner. And there were a variety of ways we could have gone. What we did, we bought out that owner through an ESOP, an employee stock option plan. What that led to, and it took a period of time because we had to incur some debt and we had to pay it off over a 7-year period. In 7 years, that company was 100% employee owned. If you weren't coming to work every day, you didn't own any stock in our company. Okay? So our leadership philosophy, in terms of looking out for the best interests of others, wasn't lip service. We put it into practice. It meant something. The second key, the second fundamental, trust the team. Team. And the team was trustworthy. And number three, thanks to Jack Davis, outwork the competition and go the extra mile. Okay, foundation, the third fundamental, and I just so you guys all know, I don't claim originality for very many things. This is one thing I originated. Backseat driver manager. Backseat driver manager. I see frowns. Nobody likes the backseat driver, right? Negative connotation. I couldn't disagree more. If you're in my car and you're in the backseat of my car, and there are six of us in the car, let's say we're going through Greenland, and you see a tractor trailer coming the other way at 60 miles an hour, and you say, Rick, there's a tractor trailer coming. If I say, yeah, I know, I see it, no harm. If I didn't see it, and you saved everybody's life, okay, now that means something. Well, backseat driver management, speak up. We hired a extremely talented lady one. Had an incredible resume as a creative director in retail. And she came into a meeting with 10 people in the meeting. We're sitting around a conference room table, brainstorming a new marketing concept. There's Jennifer was her name. She's no longer with us. But at any rate, At the end of 2.5 hours, this highly paid, highly experienced, highly talented person didn't add one word to the conversation. When the meeting was over, I took her aside and I told her how glad we were to have her on board, and I recognized her accomplishments, and I said, Jennifer, I said, you were in this meeting for 2.5 hours. I said, I know you had great ideas, but you didn't speak up. Now, why didn't you speak up?
She was probably analyzing everyone's thoughts, and then once interpreted, come up with a solution.
You could be right, okay, but what I think she was doing, I think she had thoughts. See, we were growing as a marketing agency. We were hiring people like her that had the experience to fit our vision. She may have been the most knowledgeable person in the room, I think because of personal inhibitions. You know, she was kind of new, she was kind of intimidated, and because of personal inhibitions, she didn't speak up. That's self-centered, okay? And what I asked her to do, you know, from now on, I said, Jennifer, get yourself out of the way and contribute, because we know you can contribute. And I also added that if you don't speak up in these meetings, won't be very long, we won't be inviting you to the meeting. And again, the backseat driver management, you can't do any harm in this meeting. You can only help. There's a great scripture that we use quite a bit. Iron sharpens iron, as a friend sharpens a friend. And you know, to your point, but in that sharpening process, guess what happens? There's some friction, man, okay? And that's good. It's the friction that sharpens the blade. So speak up, generate some friction. We're not talking about people. We don't want people to complain. We don't want people second guessing. But if you have an idea, if you can contribute something, speak up, don't worry. My best friend in the company, and it's one of those people from New Brighton, I stopped him. And I know him well, and he's, you know, when you're coaching, you have kids, some kids, you know, you gotta be easier with. Some kids, you really have to kind of give them that proverbial kick in the butt. Well, this guy, he's the guy you can kick in the butt, and he gets motivated. Well, we, again, another meeting type setting, 2-3 hour meeting, and we're trying to solve some internal problems. The meeting's over, we've got everything resolved. Two minutes after the meeting's over, he comes to my office and he adds something that he didn't want to say in front of somebody new. We called everybody back together, right into the conference room. I said, okay, Kim, now say what you have to say. Okay, but we speak up, iron sharpens iron. So fundamental number three, my management principle, backseat driver management, easy to remember. Okay, the fourth, this is where the rubber really starts to meet the road, and I'm gonna tell you right now, this is where it gets difficult. This is where it gets difficult. If I passed out a test right now, and it had 100 multiple choice questions on it, describing situations and how you should act or what you should do in this situation, A, B, C, D, E, I'm telling you, I could pass that test out and everybody in this room would get 100%. Okay? The problem is with that fundamental. You identified the fundamental, you coached to the fundamental, but you don't want to execute the fundamental. Okay, so do you have the courage to be successful? I'm going to share another scripture with you because these scriptures, let me tell you something first. You go back to that leadership principle. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, consider others above yourself, looking not only on your own interests, but also on the interests of others. For 25 years, in our annual meeting in front of, you know, 450 people, 500 people, in facility meetings, in group meetings, in one-on-one meetings, we say, this is our leadership philosophy. If you have a better that you want us to consider, please give it to us. Now, our company goes from New York to San Francisco, and you talk about diversity, we've got it all covered. okay? In 25 years, in all these meetings, asking if you have a better leadership philosophy than that, share it with us. Never once has anybody even anonymously offered a better leadership philosophy. I think that's a pretty powerful statement. I think that's an endorsement that we can all hang our hat on. But do you have the courage to find favor? Here's another proverb. Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and good success in the sight of God and man. That's Proverbs 3, verses 3 and 4. And the good success is the most original of all the translations. Okay? So the question is, in those situations, when you know the right thing to do, do you have the courage? Do you have the faith to do the right thing? Or do you hold back? Because if you have the courage and you have the faith, I'm going to tell you what, the success will definitely follow you. So, we identify the fundamentals back to this team. Okay, we identify the fundamentals. We coach to them repeatedly, and then we execute the fundamentals. That team started out 6-5. When we lost that fifth game to the little St. Mary's team that should not have beat us, but they did. They were better coached by a guy by the name of Ray Dickerson. They had a little pudgy guard that I don't know if anybody knows, Gino Sirianni. And they beat us. We were 6-5. I'll tell you what, that team, you talk about fundamentals. In fact, I know you had too many things going on to remember, but Bobby Fly remembers. This kid couldn't chew gum and walk at the same time. Well, I'll tell you what he was. He was big, and he was strong, and he was pretty mean. Am I right? His place was on the left block. When he got a pass, all he had to do is go like this and shoot a layup. That's all he could do. This Sefelt guy right here played in the right wing, could shoot, was a strong kid, could shoot as well as anybody, I think, in the whole league. If the defense came to him, he passed it to the guy down on the block. If they didn't come to him, he shot it. Okay? On the other side, similar type of setup. It changes a little bit because we have a left-hander. Our point guard, Doug Midden, executed everything flawlessly every time. This team went from 6-5 to 31-5.
Wow.
Let me tell you how good they were at executing fundamentals. That they were so good at executing fundamentals. In the championship game, now we're only talking about 12-year, you know, this is sixth grade basketball. In the championship game against Hopewell, we were so solid with our fundamentals, and we executed so well. Hopewell knew they couldn't beat us. Hopewell played a slowdown. They actually got the tip. And, no, we got the tip. We scored, went up 2-0. They held the ball for the entire first quarter without, well, they might have taken a shot at the end. We were winning 2-0 at the end of the first quarter. You get the picture. Halftime was 4-2, and the end of the game, the final score was 10-7, because we were so dominant at those fundamentals. We did the same thing every time down the court. The same options every time. Okay? But if you execute, identify the fundamentals. Coach to the fundamentals repeatedly, and then execute to those fundamentals, you'll be successful. So, where does that leave us? Pure Red. We went from a company, really a no-name, small production agency in Atlanta, Georgia, had a handful of local accounts. We did pretty well locally. Slowly but surely, we expanded our client base, and if you were to start shouting out names of major retailers around the country, there's probably about an 80% chance that we've done work for them or are currently working for them. We expanded to eight facilities that we own. We were in 10 other offices, where it's facility management, where we're in compliance operation. The successful end of that ESOP story is we were able to liquidate the ESOP at 11 times what we bought it for. And then that liquidation, if you understand that ESOP now, hit everybody, every single employee. And a lot of them had already left the company because of retirement or other reasons. All those employees shared equitably in the windfall, okay? So we mastered our fundamentals, okay? We mastered our fundamentals. We executed those fundamentals. We had the courage to go out and find that favor and find that good success. So that's the encouraging word, okay? That's the example it set. Those are the foundational qualities that I learned at Beaver Falls. And I would tell you, the greatest ambassador for Beaver Falls is, without question, Joe Neal. Okay, the greatest ambassador for Beaver Falls. I'm at the 1996 Olympics. Got invited by a client to go watch the Dream Team. The 96 Dream Team is loaded. They're playing China. They're beating them, you know, 100-40 or whatever. It wasn't a very good game. Horrible game, in fact. And I'm sitting there with a client and two people I did not know well. And the one guy sitting beside me, who actually was the way we got into it, he had the tickets. He's sitting beside me, and I'll describe him as he came across to me. He was a wealthy, obnoxious, arrogant guy. I'm sitting there, I'm just making casual conversation. I look down the row we're in, the very row we're in, go about seven seats, step into the aisle, there's an attractive lady beside her, with a ball cap pulled down to his eyebrows, and sunglasses on, is Joe Neal. You know, if you're from Beaver Falls, you recognize Joe Neal. The posture, you know what I mean? And so I'm just making small talk because the game wasn't very entertaining. I said to this, Norvin Hagen is the guy's name, Geographics. I said to Norvin Hagen, I said, see that guy in the ball cap? I said, that's Joe Neal. And he said, that's not Joe Neal. And he said it loud enough that a few people in front heard him say it. And they turned around, where's Joe Neal? And they said, no, that's not Joe Neal. And okay, let's go, you know, what are you going to do? So when it came time for us to leave, I led our group, four guys, and we went out the long way. The short way out would have been to the left. I led us out this way. I get into the aisle. Now, I don't want to blow his cup. So what I quietly said, I said, Beaver Falls, 1960. And he looked up at me. Now, Joe Namath doesn't know me. He's never met me. I said, Beaver Falls, 1960. He looked up at me, and as enthusiastic as if it had been Bob Pelai himself sitting there, he said, all right, a boy from the falls. he jumps out, steps over his wife, shakes my hand, asks me my name, Rick Davis, Dan and Tim Davis, and we're chit-chatting, and boy, you know what happened. Within a couple minutes, there were 50 people gathered around. I said, Joe, nice talking to you. that story says a lot about these folks. Okay, here's the arrogant, obnoxious, rich print guy. He owns a print company. And here's Joe Neal. Joe Neal, if he would have just given me a nod, and he didn't have to do anything. If he would just looked up and nodded, that was all I was looking for and expecting. But Beaver Falls people are different, and I'm thrilled to be one of those people. I'm going to close with, and I thought about bringing the video in for Wendy to put on there. Everybody familiar with the movie Jerry Maguire? You remember the end of the movie Dickie Fox? Dickie Fox was his mentor. And Dickie Fox looked at the end of the movie, he said, in life, I'm embellishing, I'm taking liberties here, but here's what I have to say in Dickie Fox's mold. In life, I've failed as much as I've succeeded. But I love my Lord and Savior, the source of my wisdom and courage. I love my wife. I love my family. I love my friends. I love my life in Beaver Falls. And I sincerely wish you my kind of happiness.
Thanks again for coming out this evening. Our final lecture will be in 2 weeks, April 13th, and that'll be Mrs. Regina Jones. Many of you know her as a person who lives in Beaver Falls now. But thanks again for coming out. There's some coffee and refreshments up there, along with some CDC information. So hope yourself. Thanks.